Okay, good morning students. We'll start with the second session. In the previous session we have studied that what is the importance of RCC. So how it is advantageous compared to the plain cement concrete. Now let us move on to the next important session of this design. Okay, that is design philosophies. As I told, basically there are three methods used to design the structural elements. So whenever we want to design the structural elements like beam, columns, footings, okay, we will going to use three methods. Okay, out of these three methods, what are the advantages of all and disadvantages of these three methods, we'll going to see. So what are these three methods? So one is working stress method, that is named as WSM, working stress method. Then ultimate load method, ULM, and third one is limit state method. Okay, so working stress method, ultimate load method, and limit state method. So previously we were used to, in the initial stages, we used to design the elements with this method, working stress method. Then it is switched over to ultimate load method. But nowadays, okay, so whatever the designs will be done using this limit state method. So one by one we'll going to see what is the working stress method, what are the disadvantages of this, then ultimate load method, and why this finally limit state method is adopted for all the countries to design the structural elements. So let us see what is this first method, that is working stress method. Now some points, important points will going to be observed here. The working stress method is based on elastic theory and is basically developed for purely elastic materials. So this point is important. Okay, so the working stress method is based on what? The theory called as classic elastic theory. Okay, so this working stress method procedure mainly depends upon this elastic theory. And we want to say that this method is purely applicable for elastic material. So what do you mean by this elastic material? Okay, the materials which are regaining its original size and shape after removing the load. So when you apply the load to the four elements, okay, at some point the stress will going to increase and simultaneously strain will going to be increased. So at particular point also, if you remove the load, the material will going to regain its original size and shape. So such materials are called as elastic materials. So this working stress method is mainly applicable for elastic materials. Okay, then second point is the method was mathematically simple in application. This method is very simple to apply the for the elements. Okay, it is simple in application. Then this method gives reasonable safety and serviceability. So again, these two are important criteria. So the whenever we're going to design, that the element should be safe and it should serviceable. Okay, so when you use this working stress method, right, it gives reasonable safety and serviceability of the elements. Then the working stress method is logically not applicable to concrete structures. See, first point you can observe here, what we can say that this method is basically applied for the elastic materials. Okay, now when you talk about the design of RCC, so as you know, RCC is basically what? It is a combination of two materials. One is steel and another will be concrete. As we know that steel is an elastic material, right? But concrete is not elastic material. Concrete is brittle material. Okay, so as soon as if you apply the load, okay, right, it will going to fail. Means after particular load carrying capacity, then it will going to fail. Before failure, concrete will not going to give any warning. That is important. So all the brittle materials, when their capacity reaches, okay, after that they will going to fail without giving any warning. So such materials are called as brittle materials. But what about elastic materials? Okay, So before failure, they will going to intimate or they will going to show the right failure pattern. Okay, so those are elastic materials. So since RCC is a combination of concrete and steel, so concrete is a brittle material. But what this method used? So this method is basically applied for elastic materials. So since concrete is not elastic material, no doubt steel is elastic material, but concrete is also there in RCC. So this working stress method is logically not applicable to concrete structures. But what initially when we use this working stress method, it is assumed that concrete is also elastic material and this method was applied, but that is not logically correct. If you see the stress strain curve, so this is strain, x axis is strain and y axis is stress. So if you apply the load, so this diagram is for concrete, stress strain diagram for concrete. So as the stress increases, strain also increases. See the curve, right? The curve is continuously like this, so there is no neck formation, okay, like that, as if you compare to the steel stress strain diagram. Okay, so the working stress method assumes that materials of which the structure is made up of, normally that is concrete and steel, both obeys the Hooke's law. When the material will going to obey the Hooke's law? Okay, when the materials are elastic. So elastic materials will going to obey the Hooke's law. So here what happens, we assume that concrete is also elastic material, steel is also elastic material, and both will going to obey the Hooke's law, but that is not correct. Okay, steel obeys the Hooke's law, but what about concrete? Since it is a brittle material, this will not going to obey the Hooke's law, but still we assume that to apply this method, we assume that both are elastic material. Now if you see the stress strain diagram also, okay, see the there will be a continuous curve from this origin. Okay, it is not a straight line. Okay, thus the whatever the basic assumption is that linear stress strain relationship is not applied here. So stress is not proportional to strain. If it is not proportional, then Hooke's law will not going to be applicable. Okay, that is a important point you can observe. Next, another thing you can observe here, when there is no linearity between stress and strain, okay, Young's modulus will going to change. Okay, so when stress is not directly proportional to strain, okay, Young's modulus of elasticity will going to be changed. That is capital E, what we can say that Young's modulus of elasticity of steel and Young's modulus of elasticity of concrete will going to change. Okay, then another important point is it does not predict true margin of safety. So why are we going to design the elements? Okay, when the load, various load comes on the elements, we should know what will be the margin of safety. Safety is an important factor to get the safe designed elements. Okay, so safety is important factor. So when we use this working stress method, it will not going to predict, or it will not going to give clear picture of what is the margin of safety. Okay, that is important. So why it is not there? The method considers, that is working stress method considers only the elastic part of OA of stress strain curve and ignores the plastic region AB. So see here, this stress strain curve. So there are various parts OA and AB. If you divide the two regions, OA is called as elastic region and AB is called as plastic region. So once it crosses elastic region, then it will comes into plastic region. So OA is elastic region, AB is plastic region. So in this method, what happens, it will going to consider the only OA part, not AB part, this method, working stress method. Okay, so only the elastic part OA of stress strain curve, and it ignores the plastic region AB, and therefore the stress of the material near the failure is not considered. So the material will going to fail here in this region. Okay, so whatever the stress is there, the stress for which the material will going to fail, that will not be considered. So the stress in this region will not be considered. Okay, the stress of material near the failure is not considered. So it is unable to predict. So we are not considering the stress in the plastic region. So we are not going to get the correct margin of safety. So when the material fails, what will be the margin of safety we are not going to get. That is one more, you can say the disadvantage of this method, that is working stress method. Then another point is additional load carrying capacity in the plastic region is not taken into consider. So in this method, the region, plastic region is not at all considered. So whatever the load carrying capacity in this region is not taken into account. It considers ultimate stress as the limit state, a limit of safety, but safety is function of ultimate strain and not ultimate stress. So when you use this method, okay, the limit of safety is considered as whatever the ultimate stress is there. Ultimate stress itself is considered as limit of safety, but safety is a function of what? Ultimate strain, not ultimate stress. Okay, in this method, what we consider ultimate stress is the safety of the limit of safety, but ultimate strain we are not going to consider. Ultimate strain is right the final limit of safety, but that is not considered in this method. Since the structure is subjected to loads, okay, then the load should form the failure criteria and not the stress. Okay, so when the structure put into use, the various loads will going to act on the structure. So the load should form the failure criteria, not the stress. Okay, here what happens, we're going to consider stress as the basic criteria for the safety, but loads will going to form the safety, that will not be considered here. Then factor of safety does not predict the true margin of safety. Okay, so as you know, this will not going to give the clear picture of what is the margin of safety. And another important thing is the effect of creep and shrinkage. Okay, so these are the two important parameters, especially for the concrete. Okay, when you consider the concrete, okay, the two important factors comes into picture is creep and shrinkage. So whenever the temperature changes, okay, so the material will going to expand. If the temperature increases, okay, the material will going to expand, and if the temperature reduces, the material will going to contract. So this expansion and contraction process is called as creep and shrinkage. Basically, this is applicable for the concrete. So the effect of creep and shrinkage of concrete is totally ignored. So in this method, working stress method, even though we are using the concrete, okay, and steel, okay, so when you consider the concrete, these two parameters should be considered, but this method will not going to be considered, creep and shrinkage effect of concrete, that these two will be ignored. Then failure load, another important thing is the failure load calculated by this method in majority of the cases is less than that obtained by the experimental result. So if you find out the what is the total load carrying capacity of the element, okay, by experimental, right, so when you compared this with the load carried by the element, so by using this method, always the load calculated will be less than what is experimental results. Okay, so these are some of the disadvantages of this working stress method. Okay, initially whatever the designs were done, all these designs were done using working stress method, but since there are some disadvantages, so to overcome these disadvantages, the next method was developed, that is ultimate load method. As the name itself indicates, ultimate load. Ultimate load will be considered as the margin of safety. So in this method, the structural element is proportioned to withstand the ultimate load. So whatever the element is designed, this will be designed to take the ultimate load. Ultimate load means it is a final load at the failure. Whatever the load which comes at the failure, that will be considered as ultimate load. And this ultimate load is obtained by enhancing the service load. So now consider there are two loads. One will be service load and another will be ultimate load. What is the difference between this service load and ultimate load? So service load. So during the functioning of the structure, during its lifespan, functioning of the structure, so whatever the load comes, those loads are called as service load. Then what about this ultimate? So this service load will be increased. So we don't know after some 50 years. Okay, so the other loads may act on the structure. We don't know, right? So there should be some margin of safety. So the element will be designed not for the service load. It will be designed for the ultimate load. So this service load will be increased by multiplying a factor called as load factor. So some additional load will be considered, right? So service load multiplied by the load factor will be the final load, that is ultimate load. So this ultimate load will be more than this service load. Okay, so the service load will be increased by multiplying the load factor, we're going to get the ultimate load. And this, in this method, ultimate load method, we're going to consider this ultimate load, not working load or not service load. Okay, then the stress block parameters are defined by the actual stress strain curve. So actual stress strain curve is there, whatever the stress strain curve is there for the materials, that will be considered for the design. Then the method uses actual stress strain curve. Now in this method, what happens? Only we are considering the OA part, but here it is OAB, right? Elastic region also and plastic region is also considered for the design. Okay. Next, right, then the another important factor is the calculated failure load matches the experimental result. If you see, compare whatever the experimental results are there and whatever you will going to calculate by this method, the both the loads means the load at the load at which the material will going to fail, that is called as a failure load. So failure load will be same for experimental results also and by using this method also, right? Then it utilizes the reserve strength of plastic region. So here also it will be, in this method, the plastic region is also considered for the calculation. Then it takes ultimate strain as the failure criteria. Okay, so in the previous case, what happens? Ultimate stress was considered as a failure criteria, but here ultimate strain, that is correct, ultimate strain as the failure criteria. Then the load causing the collapse is taken as the limit of safety. At the time of collapsing the structure or at the time of failure, whatever the load is there, that is considered as the limit of safety, means that is the limit for the material. Okay, so we can say that ultimate load, or it is also called as factored load. So ultimate load or factored load is equal to working load multiplied by some factor, that is called as load factor. Okay, then it totally neglects the serviceability criteria of deflection and cracking. So whenever the load comes, okay, so during a course of time, there will be some small deflection will be there, right? Then cracking will be also be there, because since because of this creep and shrinkage, okay, cracking will be there in the concrete structures. Okay, so this method, if we use this method, okay, this will going to neglect the serviceability criteria. That is, these two comes under serviceability. So this will not going to be considered deflection. It will not going to consider the cracking criteria. So the design gives slender or thin sections, right, which leads to the excessive deformations and cracking. So when you design the elements, suppose if you design the column or a beam using this ultimate load method, what happens? So after designing, we're going to get the dimension which are very less. Okay, we're going to get the slender section. Slender means thin sections. So by using this method, if you design, the sections will be thin sections. If the section is thin, what is the problem? There will be excessive deformation will going to take place and cracking will going to occur. Okay, so the main disadvantage of this method is what? We're going to get the thin sections, which leads to the deformation and cracking. The effect of deflection due to creep and shrinkage is neglected. So here also, in this method also, the effect of creep and shrinkage is neglected. Again, this is a disadvantageous point. Thus, the ultimate load method ensures safety. No doubt, this method will going to give the safe design, that is, ensures safety, but disagrees. Okay, it will not going to give the serviceability aspects. No doubt, it will going to give the safety, but it will not going to give the serviceability aspects. That is disadvantage. Okay, now whatever the disadvantages are there for working stress method and for this limit state method, these will be overcome by another method which will be applicable all over the world, that is called as limit state method. So what this limit state method says that? So as we know that working stress method gives satisfactory performance at working loads. In the first method, it gives the satisfactory performance at working loads, but it is not correct at ultimate load. Okay, at working load it is fine, but at the ultimate load it will going to fail, and hence does not give true margin of safety. While this ultimate load method, the second method, while the ultimate load method provides correct assessment of degree of safety at ultimate stress, it does not guarantee for the what working loads. Okay, reverse. So to overcome these two disadvantages of working stress method and limit state method, okay, there is a method called as limit state method. Then what is this limit state method? We're going to give what are the important advantages of this limit state method. We're going to see the limit state method ensures the safety, okay, at ultimate load and serviceability at working load. So the both the disadvantages of the two previous methods will be taken care. That is, okay, this method will going to give safety of the structure at ultimate load, means at the failure load, at ultimate load, and serviceability at working loads. During the working loads, it will be serviceable, and at the ultimate load, it will going to give the true margin of safety. Okay, then this method considers the actual behavior of structure, okay, during the entire loading history up to collapse. So from starting point to the failure, whatever the load comes, that load will be considered for the design. Okay, it will going to consider the actual behavior of the structure during the entire loading history up to the collapse. Then it adopts the concept of fitness of structure to serve the desired function during the service lifespan. So whatever the lifespan is there, 120 years, 150 years like that, so it will going to provide the fitness of the structure. It attempts to define quantitatively the margin of safety or fitness on some scientific mathematical basis. So when you use this method, yes, it is possible to measure the margin of safety quantitatively. Okay, so that is important advantage of this method. Then this method is based on statistical probabilistic principle. So this method is mainly depending on what theory? That is statistical probabilistic principle. So finally, we can say that after going through all these three methods, so whatever the disadvantages are there in working stress method and ultimate load method, those will be overcome, and the method which was developed to design the structural element is limit state method. So finally, you can say that thus in the limit state method, a structure is essentially designed, that is the structure is designed considering that safety against the collapse, that is ultimate strength, then checked for its serviceability. Both, you're going to design the structure considering the ultimate load or the ultimate strength, and it is also checked for the serviceability at working loads. Considering the ultimate load, you are going to design, and the structure will be checked for serviceability against working load. So nowadays, right, so we are using, not only we, all over the country, the all the RCC elements will be designed by the using this limit state method. Okay, so important thing, remember what is working stress method, what are the advantages of this, disadvantages of this, then second method is ultimate load method, there are some disadvantages also there. So to overcome disadvantages of working stress method and ultimate load method, the finally the method which was developed is limit state method. So limit state method is exceptionally good, and it will going to give the correct design of structural elements or structure. So this is what I wanted to tell you. So in the next session, we'll move on to the further. Okay, again, extended part of this, how this limit state method can be used for the design of structural elements, we're going to see. Okay, I hope you understood this, right? So we'll meet on the next session. Thank you for attending this session. Thank you very much.